try to swerve away, but the Cadillac hits the truck amidships and right on its on the Cadillac's right front bumper. Now, all reports say that what happened was Patton went flying through the air. Nobody saw this. They're just speculating. Anyway, when the crash ends, and they're going anywhere from 10 to 35 miles an hour, in the lore, it's sort of a fender bender. And I don't argue with that. It's not a, a tremendous hit. Only Patton ends up with a broken neck. The other two people in it aren't even scratched. And this is a driver who nobody put their arms up. There's no hurt anywhere. Only Patton. He supposedly flies through the air, breaks his neck, and then flies back. There was about a 5-foot area.
Bob, we're going to give you free rein on the other side of the break. We're at that hard break again. We're going to get Bob a chance to go through the narrative unfettered. Listen carefully.
Dale Williams on K-Talk. AM 630 KTKK.
Okay, a couple of decent intervals now in the middle of the show for Bob and for the balance of the show for Bob to go through the full narrative to get to the main event, which we've done great background on last hour. We're right in the middle of the accident, Bob, so carry on.
So this truck turns for no apparent reason right in front of it. They crash. Patton is the only one hurt. He has a broken neck, and he has a tremendous gash on his in his face and up to his head. And there's blood all over the back seat. Well, this is a quiet Sunday morning. It's on a remote road, and all of a sudden, out of the woodwork come. And this is one of the most interesting things to me. I mean, so many people came. There must have been 100 people who came out of the woodwork on this thing. Mysterious people. There were two or three sets of MPs that came. There was a general who came. This nobody knew he was down there. I mean, this is very, very odd. And anyway, the guy who drove the truck, his name is Robert L. Thompson. He has two passengers with him. And Robert L. Thompson is a very strange guy. He's as I research him later, and nobody ever heard of him later, but I did. He's a black marketeer guy, and Bezzotta told. See, I don't want to jump into everything, but Bezzotta said he staged this accident.
Mm-hmm.
And anyway, they take Bezzotta to the. They take Patton to the hospital. They don't take him to a hospital in Mannheim. They take him about 20 miles south to Heidelberg, where he is admitted, and he was in bad, bad shape. But he fights back, and well, let me say something else. One of the first things I did once I got all the information on the accident was I went to the National Archives to find the reports that these three different sets of policemen, military policemen, would have written, as well as the others who would have written. This is the highest ranking general on the continent at the time. It's Patton, and in the book you'll see. Headlines everywhere. I mean, banner headlines. He's hurt. There are no reports. I know for a fact that at least five of them existed. they are mentioned in other documents that I find. The report by a certain Lieutenant Balabas, who was one of the Babalas, who was one of those who was there at the scene. Babalas himself, years later, tried to find his report. It's gone. Two other reports, and then there were investigations into it. They are all gone. Now, one, two, or three of these even, I might say, is coincidental. But 5 to 8, which is the number that I work with, no way. This is a cover-up. Every stitch of any information about that accident is gone. It's gone from the National Archives. It's gone from everywhere. I checked in Europe, and there are no documents. Well, Patton is taken to a hospital, to the Heidelberg Hospital, and at first they think he's going to die. I mean, he's got a broken neck. He does have a little tiny little feeling, a little bit in the toes and this kind of thing. Well, he's a tough guy, and he makes a literal miraculous recovery. And within a week and a half, he is ready to be flown home, which is no easy trip in those days. They were going to fly him home to Boston where he could get better care and continue to recuperate. He's out of the danger zone. And he suddenly has a downturn. Within 14 hours, he's dead. He dies. He has what they call embolism. These are little clots that get in your blood. And he did have that before as a younger man. He'd had the same thing. In fact, people who are in the hospital for long periods get them. And I'm jumping ahead a little bit, as I uncover, the Russians actually, a Russian colonel actually tries to contact one of the Patton family and tell him that they actually sprayed something or injected something into the room, which is right off of a street in that hospital, to make him have pneumonia, which, by the way, is part of what he died of. He did have pneumonia when he died.
Mm-hmm.
But at the time that he died, there is no autopsy. There's no autopsy. And there are rumors rife all over Germany that he's been killed by the Germans. Not a lot that he'd been killed by us, by the Russians, and certainly nothing that we'd had anything to do with it. But and here is, you know, this is a banner type thing. Why no autopsy?
Here comes our next interval, our commercial interval. Robert Wilcox, author of Target Patton, and Bob has deconstructed all of the happenings, all of the backstory to what he's describing right now. He'll have plenty of time to get at it in our long segments coming right up. Don't go away.
Dale Williams on K-Talk. AM 630 KTKK.
Okay, Bob Wilcox, carry on if you would.
Okay, I wanted to say that, we last left that that here is this greatest general, certainly in our lifetimes, if not the best we ever had. He dies mysteriously, and there's no autopsy. And there had been three attempts that I believe earlier to kill him. If you ever saw the movie Patton, which is a great movie, I think, it ended with they kind of were nebulous about it, but you see this cart come out of an alley and almost hit him, and that actually happened. This was maybe 3 months before the fatal accident.
Yeah, except that there was a scythe sticking out of it.
Well, there was a scythe in it, yes. A scythe being the something you cut wheat down with. It's actually, ironically, the symbol of Russia. And that scythe almost decapitated him, and he was in a Jeep, which was not in the movie. But that didn't happen, and there's very little about that in any records as well. The one that, there were three. The one that is most important, I think, was when he was in a light plane, and he had a like a Piper Cub type plane that he would fly around to his various installations, his various armies, and it was a quick way to get around. And one day, right at the end of the war, he was in Germany, and they were hedge hopping around in this little plane, and all of a sudden, a flight of four Polish Spitfires came above him. And then I think in a classic maneuver, one of them goes down and they try to shoot him down, while the other three are up there hovering in sort of a lookout way. Thank goodness the pilot he had was so good that he was able to dive so close to the ground that when the Spitfire trying to shoot him dove at him, he couldn't pull up, and he crashed. I tried to find out about that. There's when it happened in both the Patton diary and in General Gay, his aide's diary, they are livid. What the heck's going on here? We're going to find out if somebody, heads are going to roll for this, but you don't hear any more about it. There's no indication of what happened. I actually dealt with Polish fighter pilots.